Without further ado, I'll just introduce our speaker for today. Cornel Ban is an associate professor of international political economy at Copenhagen Business School, having previously spent time at City University of London, Boston University, and Brown University in the United States. He has an extensive portfolio of work on the politics of economic expertise, working particularly on macroeconomic policy and organizational and ideational shifts within institutions, in particular international financial institutions. A recent book, and there's lots of work that I'd highly recommend you seek out. A recent book from 2017, Ruling Ideas, How Neoliberalism Went Local by Oxford University Press, won a award by the British International Studies Association. So there's, we're very, very glad and very pleased that Cornel could join us today. So thank you very much for your time. And without further ado, let's have a good session.
Thank you, Christina. They say that that wars and pandemics change the world, but do they change mainstream economics? I think that's the kind of question that we are dealing with here today. And of course, history is not a very good an accurate guide at telling us anything useful about it. A 6% collapse in GDP after the Spanish flu has not led to major changes in the mainstream economics of the 1920s, of the kind of neoclassical marginalist brand. However, the combination of World War II and the Great Depression has. So the evidence we have is quite random. And in that regard, since the previous pandemic hasn't led to much change, I asked this very opportunistic question. What has the pandemic done to mainstream macroeconomics? It is indeed this realm that I'm most interested in my work. The specific sub-questions here are as follows. Who really controlled so far, at least in the last 2 months of lockdown, who has controlled the debate on what is to be done in macroeconomic terms to cope with the COVID-induced recession? And second, how have mainstream economists coped with what's going on? On to the first question, both questions are addressed by looking at a very elite group of economists. Of course, the debate is extremely rich. It's carried out by professional and non-professional economists in various media outlets. But there is a very specific elite post where one gets to speak with the loudspeaker of authority. And that is Vox EU, which is a portal for essentially advertising the research of policy-relevant economists, affiliated or advertised by CPR. We know that CPR, the Center for European Reform, is essentially a platform for transatlantic economists for the most part, increasingly also economists from the global south, very few, however, to air their editorial views. So it is indeed an ideal setting to study how the profession has coped with the challenges posed by what is indeed a public health induced lockdown, compression of both supply and demand. Okay, so first let me say, let's look at this. What I've done is that I spoke to a colleague at Boston University. She's about to study her doctorate at Brown University. Her name is Shanuki Tilakaradni, and I and her coordinated established what are the individual names of the economists who participate in this emerging field of COVID economics. It's actually called COVID economics on the website. But looking at the institutions they come from. So the question is, what are the most important suppliers of professional experiences of the economists participating in the debate? So now I will share the screen with you to see this network, which is you know, it's quite beautiful in the sense that it enables us to see who's at the core and who is the periphery of this debate. So let's zoom into it, because of course the coding was applied to 75 biographies, which were weighted by the seniority of the people involved. So the more senior, the thicker the node. Yeah. So the closer you are to the core. And then also time spent. So it's weighted by time. The minimum threshold was 1 year. So let's say it's 1 to 3 years, 3 to 7, and more than 7. And here's what we see. We see some things that we expect and some things that we don't. Keep in mind, we have coded both primary affiliation as well as secondary affiliations that are longer, that are anywhere between 1 year and 20 years. And then we found that the most influential Mandarin elite here, institutions, are mostly these kind of transatlantic think tanks and high prestige sites of applied economics, which is CPR itself. Of course, National Bureau for Economic Research in the United States. And interestingly, of the university spectrum that we would expect and associate with mainstream economics, we find only Harvard that somewhat confirms our expectations. And as we can see, Harvard is here. It supplies a lot of professional experiences of these debaters. But Columbia is even more important. And including people at the business school and the public policy school there. And then a bunch of European, highly influential European think tanks, such as Bruegel, you know, very center-right, Bruegel, Center for European Reform, and Graduate Institute of Geneva. As we know, Vox is run by Charles Ripslotz, who's based there. There's a bunch of people coming from that area. Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. And what we don't see here, and this is interesting, right? Because if indeed we are thinking of macroeconomics being controlled by some kind of Ivy League cabal combined with central banks and international financial institutions, we actually don't find them very well represented here. I mean, if you look at something as important as COVID and monetary policy should be addressed by, say, Fed and the ECB economists. But as you can see, the ECB is a tiny speck here, and the Federal Reserve Bank is here. I mean, the Fed matters as much as SURF or Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, right? So there seems to be a little bit of a reorganization of who gets to be invited, who gets to count as a strong voice in this regard. And it's maybe not, I don't know if this is going to last, but it's not the kind of coalition we had in the 1980s. It was very much like the Boston, Washington, Chicago kind of trade, right? It is quite different. And it is dominated by Europeans, which is not all that surprising considering the nature of the crisis and of VoxU. You know, particularly University of Chicago, which you can see here, appears to be quite outside of the inner circle, so to say. Now let's go a little bit into the substantive ideas being discussed. And in my book, I define neoliberalism in a sort of unusual sense as a sum of specific technical ideas and policy ideas that are meant to define three core assumptions and three paradigmatic goals. And they are financial and trade openness, yeah, as one core, then domestic and external competitiveness as the second one, and then the third one, openness. So credibility, sorry. Any kind of public policy has to be vetted by the financial markets. And if they don't, it's not credible. So neoliberalism thus appears as a very hybrid policy and intellectual paradigm that can incorporate Keynesian elements. It can incorporate, Islam, Islamic finance elements. It can incorporate, you know, extremely different heterogeneous ideas. But as long as it sticks to this core, then it remains a coherent a coherent sort of Lakatoshian program, you could say, that doesn't degenerate. Now, what do we find? What is the big finding here? Having surveyed, having read what the 75 economists that participated in the debate have written, and what kind of policies they suggested, and what kind of assumptions they have made, the most important finding here is that neoliberalism is suspended. It is suspended by and maybe saved, very much like in 2008. We are kind of repeating September to December 2008, when a very similar, let's call it state of exception Keynesianism, right? Or sunspot Keynesianism, if you wish, where as a mainstream economist, you can defend your proposals to have unlimited fiscal spending during COVID, you know, ask that all wages be paid by the state, et cetera, et cetera. Because this, we're talking about, in economic language, about an extrinsic random variable, right? That generates extreme economic uncertainty that cannot be related to economic fundamentals, right? So intellectually, you have people such as Alberto Alesina, right? That is a well-known, as my colleague here at CBS, Odmigel Helgadotti has showed, the Bocconi School of Economics that transcends the two sides of the Atlantic and connects Bocconi with the American coastal universities, has been the intellectual author of the famous expansionary austerity thesis, which has wrought a great deal of damage in various adjustment programs on the continent. Well, these people now come and say, nobody should lose their jobs. And if they do, their wages should be replaced up to 100%. We're looking at people that are well-known neoliberals, in other words, saying that moral hazard considerations in monetary policy and sovereign debt management should be suspended, that the priority of policy should be to avoid bankruptcies of corporates at any cost, including subsidies. There should be no considerations. There's no freak out about picking winners. This is explicitly said. We should not worry about picking winners now. And to the extent that that the winners rear their ugly head in post-COVID, then we should deal with them. But until then, we are suspending neoliberalism, essentially. Job subsidies. You know, Luis Garicano, a very famous new classical economist out there, arguing for the same 100% wage replacement set of policies, support for the financial system in order to avoid non-performing loans. I mean, everything's pretty much thrown off the window. Now, the interesting thing, as some of the founding fathers of political economy say, is that the things that are not said are as important as the things that they are said, right? So, so we have massive expansionary fiscal policy Keynesianism. It's all there. There's nothing like expansionary austerity thesis being resurrected. Very expansionary monetary policy in the case of the Eurozone, on which the focus of much of this analysis falls. ONT plus ESM programs for all countries, so we avoid the stigma of taking an ESM program. There's a little bit of debate around helicopter money, with some people being skeptical, but many of them, including some of the usual suspects from which you would expect very strong neoliberal arguments, such as Hordik Ali, essentially arguing for helicopter money interventions in this case. Dealing with that, I mean, the problem is, okay, you expand the economy, but you build up debt. So how do you deal with it? Everybody is basically, so in the kind of political spectrum that we have in dealing with the emerging sovereign debt refinancing problems in Europe at this point, in the countries that have been hit the heaviest by COVID, you know, most of these economies would be on the sort of Italian, Spanish, spectrum of preferences. They would not be on the side. I haven't found anyone on Vox EU that would support the Dutch view, for example. Of course, some of the people that have made an inroad into into the sort of neoliberal mainstream between 08 and this crisis, such as Pierre Grinchas, for example, from Berkeley. They are, or Paul Krugman, he also appears at the end. He's been given a very important position there, a kind of a keynote speaker for the one of the books that was published. They have pushed Keynesianism even further to the left, we could say, in the sort of left, meaning state interventionist left. For example, Krugman now has moved to argue for a permanent 2% stimulus program, irrespective of the cycles. And he even fantasizes about the first Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez presidency to implement it. So we are in some ways, we are in very, very different territory here. So we do see a sort of like suspension of neoliberalism that's being thrown onto the safety net provided by emergency Keynesianism, because that's probably the best label I could think of. Some people talk about emergency statism, but in the case of these economists, without, of course, citing Keynesians, these are very short pieces, it is Keynesian thinking in many ways. And some versions of Keynesianism are closer to Kaletsky. In some ways. But now the question is, this is all delimited by the possibilities of the pandemic ending, and then the silences in the text will tell us that austerity is coming. Nobody, for instance, is talking about, you know, in the 1930s, there was, you know, some of the fundamental institutions of embedded liberalism, such as progressive taxation or the welfare state, were adopted in the middle of the depression by left governments and sometimes right governments. That's not happening now. Nobody's talking about a tax on wealth or a tax on corporates that made money during this. There's no discussion of financial repression. This is not a return to embedded liberalism and Carmen Reinhardt's description of a financial repression, not at all. This is a state of exception in the thinking and nothing else. It would therefore be completely unsurprising if, following all this, Gavazzi and Alessina and others represented here and Garicano would come back and say, yeah, it is time to now expand the economy through some internal devaluation. So we'll go back to the grinder of 2010, 2012 in many ways. So to conclude, I believe I have about 5 minutes left, if I'm not mistaken. What does this all mean, right? What do we take home? Well, first, the discussion in terms of is this pandemic likely to kill neoliberalism? There's a lot of debate out there. If we actually look at a site of prestige, where I'm not an economist, but if I were to be some random economist with some serious research, but not a famous economist, I will not get invited to publish in Vox, right? This is a very clear sort of gatekeeping device. So if you look at this very prestigious site, which is populated mostly by white European males with a few economists invited from Asian universities, but dealing mostly with the issues regarding to the health crisis rather than with the macroeconomics of it. This discussion is controlled by this old transatlantic European class of Mandarin economists. And some of them, there's quite a, we calculated, if I'm not mistaken, around 15-20% of them are from the kind of Keynesian revisionism that emerged after the 2008 crisis. And some of them, like Krugman, people who are known, who have known flirts with old Keynesianism, yes, in many ways. But overall, it is the old crowd. And the old crowd has instituted this special regime, yes, this emergency Keynesianism. Now, the thing to keep in mind here is that to the extent that people are thinking about COVID as a sunspot event, right? That's not generated by fundamentals. Let's keep in mind that mainstream models have modeled sunspots in predicting asset prices, in monetary policy, and so on and so forth. So it would not be surprising at all to see in a couple of months, provided there is some kind of significant recovery coming back, and the disease dying out. I would not be surprised if the old books would be read again, yeah, to us, and modeled, right? So people will start modeling, pandemic economics. Let's keep in mind also that most of this debate, the new Keynesians, like I said, have really moved further to the left, but not in the sort of like let's suspend the conventional thinking. They actually argue for a real sort of reshuffling of economic knowledge post-COVID as well, right? That's at least what we've been reading in Krugman and Pierre Gourinchas. So these are the basic findings. I will only add to this the fact that if we were to compare the emerging transformation of macroeconomics in the last 2 months with the first 2 months of the Lehman crisis, which should be our basis for evaluation, we are not seeing in this crowd the kind of radical challenges that we have seen last time around. For example, we've had people that have completely, who are published in top 20 journals, right, in that period. And they were preparing them during these first 2 months, but they were published a year or 2 years later. People who have destroyed the core of ESG modeling. They have argued that one needs to work with non-rational expectations, right? And without rational expectations, ESG doesn't hold. Those were not numerous, but they represented about 20% of the overall population of cases that I've been looking at in a previous study. There is an orthodox reassertion of the conventional wisdom at the time. Now it seems like a lot of the orthodox are either silent or are presenting COVID economics as a sort of exceptional sunspot, right? That should not be, whatever they're saying now should not be taken to mean that it means that they've converted to Keynesianism. That is very, very, the very clear message that comes out of the analysis. And finally, in the previous crisis, there was a lot of calibration of orthodoxy, and I call them revisionists in my book. So people like Woodford and Kolbjorn, Gorodnichenko, this kind of new young Turks of the mainstream have calibrated models with cost and rational expectations. Some of the most sort of cutting edge central bankers have argued for the necessity of having macroeconomic models that run on very different assumptions, and one should not prejudge rational expectations-based models as being the alpha males on the block necessarily, right? Including the Fed. Fed has done this, some European central banks as well. This time around, we're seeing a sort of panic and searching for ways to salvage the coherence of the thinking. And they are salvaging it. They're saying, look, this is exceptional. Just put it on the shelf. It doesn't mean anything for anything else. There was no DSG modeling in 1920 to deal with the Spanish flu. So, don't hold your breath for big change. Now, we'll see what the likes of Philip Lane and Gita Gopinath and Adam Posen, will do in a year from now. But I wouldn't hold my breath. Thank you.
Brilliant. Let me just get the video back. Thank you so much, Cornel. That's great. It's really valuable to hear your initial reactions and reflections in actually such a detailed way, because it looks like you've done a lot of work in what's been a very difficult lockdown period. So thank you for sharing your thoughts.
I'm quite obsessive with this crowd.
Sorry?
I'm stalking this crowd and their work.
research is often the result of weird obsessions. Can I just ask a clarifying question and then a more substantive question? So your network is affiliated authors who contribute to VoxEU. Is that right?
It is everything that, so VoxEU opened a special file called COVID-19. And under COVID-19, you find it's literally by now, it's over 100 studies that were published, plus an ebook, right? And the ebook is the ebook concentrates most of the macroeconomic thinking, whereas the other working papers are based around microeconomics, behavioral economics, things like, you know, what does working from home mean in terms of mental stress, you know, gender inequality. There's a lot of stuff on inequality, for example, right? Whereas, you know, I'm not interested in that bit. I'm interested in the macro. So I cannot make any statements whether there has been drastic change in microeconomics and behavioral economics in that regard.
Okay. And just another clarification question about your finding or initial finding that what you might have considered usual suspects or perhaps institutions which you would expect to have more clout appearing less evident in that network. You did mention something about your initial thoughts. Yes. Do you want to just share something a little bit more about that kind of peripheral view on some of the institutions that you seem to expect would be more central?
Right. So I was being a bit histrionic in the sense that this is what the literature would expect us to think, right? Okay. I mean, there's the canon says, well, you know, there's the Chicago economics, and then it moved on the coast, and it's saltwater and freshwater, et cetera. But at the end of the day, it's still, you know, new Keynesianism is neoliberalism, et cetera. And then the continent, you know, European universities and Latin American universities went even further, right? Sort of outbidding the teachings of the masters. Well, things have changed a lot. I mean, most of the literature deals with the 80s and 90s. Most of my work deals with more, you know, the 2000s and especially the post, the 2008, 2014 period. And I've done a lot of interviews in the US with, I was fortunate to be, you know, in the Boston, Washington corridor. So I interviewed a lot of colleagues in economics departments, and they are telling me that the, you know, University of Chicago has moved away from macroeconomics to microeconomics. So being prestigious now at Chicago doesn't mean to walk in the shoes of Friedman and Becker and others. It means doing microeconomics, right? So it's not that surprising at the end of the day, but it does tell us that we should, like, you know, literally interrogate some of the conventional wisdom we have about what is mainstream economics today, what institutions supply the knowledge of prestige in applied economics. Now, of course, if we were to look at purely academic economics, and we would look at American Economics Review and people who don't care about policy at all, we probably would get a very different arrangements of status and prestige. But when it comes to policy questions, where only economists have the right to speak and only prestige economists have the right to speak, these are the findings. Now, of course, I cannot say, you know, I would like to have modeled VoxEU in 2008, in the first 2 months. That would have been a very nice experiment. I'm sure that my colleague Shanuki and others would look into that. In my models, I usually do a lot of coding of the individual pieces, and I situate people on a sort of orthodox to radical spectrum. And then the network that emerges is coded with, so you can see what are the institutions that are associated with radicalism. People who, let's say people like, what does radical mean in mainstream? It means basically Krugman, right? Or Stiglitz, or there's others actually, like Jim Furer at the Fed of Boston. These are the sort of radical minds. They do get published in the top journals. I mean, it's not a bunker economics. It has changed a lot. It has opened the door since 2008 to a lot of revisionist thinking. So I didn't have time to do this now. This is,
No, for sure. One thing that comes to mind is just drawing from other things that you've worked on in the past, is this sort of tension between the idea that there's a paradigm out there that has certain characteristics, and to what degree do crises affect or challenge a paradigm, and how, you know, another way of kind of looking at that whole thing would be through bricolage. So you just get hybridization, intellectual innovation. Yeah. There's no need to conform or, for lack of a better metaphor, you know, revert to some trend of a paradigm. And that seems to be a kind of tension in how scholars in IPE, but also elsewhere, kind of think about you know, how is a crisis affecting an institution or a discipline or a professional practice? You know, is it much of the same, or is it really changing? And I just from your presentation, you kind of, yeah, you hold on to the paradigm. You know, neoliberalism has certain characteristics. That's a paradigm. Does it fundamentally get challenged or not? And you kind of look out for these pointers. In history of economics, certainly with the concept of bricolage, I'm thinking now of the work of Verena Hallensmeyer and others who sort of look at what economists do as, I guess, what you would maybe think of as hybridization. So just kind of innovating along the way. And I'm just very curious to hear more about how you think about this tension. And I know you weigh down on the sign of paradigm, but it would be just interesting to hear more about that.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty conservative regarding the paradigm a bit. And my colleague at CBS, Martin Carstensen, has great work on bricolage. We spar quite a bit on the concept, in the sense that I find bricolage to be the way it's described as kind of like free for all intervention, mixing and matching. I don't think that's how economics works. I think especially mainstream elite economics is extremely hierarchical. Marion Fourcade has made this point, Odinger, Gadotti, and others. So there are some rules, and there's gatekeepers, and there are very hard to move structures that have to do with professional incentives and other things. So it's not some kind of, you know, a free mixing and matching in a meritocratic universe. It really isn't. I mean, of course, there's competition, but it is quite complex. And in my book, I argue for the concept of translation instead. That entails the layering and grafting and editing of economic ideas. So there is a lot of, you can call, I would be fine with bricolage as long as it refers to the periphery of the paradigm. I'm cool with that. And I think that the resilience of neoliberalism is about the endurance of the core. What we have, there is something new now with COVID. It is absolutely clear. In 2008, we have not seen so many members of the very cautious part of the mainstream come in and take positions asking for big government stimulus and paying wages. We have not seen that. This is likes of Alexina and Kukerman and Javati have done. You know, they really have been very bold. They've really gone and said, you know, I know you associate us with austerity. This is not the time. We're going to go full guns blazing on the Keynesian side. But very carefully saying it's only for the duration of, right? So it's a very dangerous move because I don't know to what extent this will open the gates to something more than an exception.
Yeah, well, the questions are still on the table. I'm just aware that we've had a series of questions come through and it might be a good time to open it up to the floor. And I don't know, Raf, if you want to step in and help with that. Thank you.
Yes, can you hear me, first of all?
I can hear you very well.
Fantastic. So we have a few questions that are coming both from our guests here and from outside, but I would invite everyone to keep sending them through. I apologize in advance if I mispronounce some of the names. The first question was from Perry Merling, who asked, do you have a sense if these mandarins are influencing actual policy or justifying policy after the fact or just talking to themselves?
Thank you, Perry. Good to hear from you. Perry and I overlap in several settings, including at BU. So you're being missed here. That would be the next stage of my work. So in my book, that's what I did. I actually followed which ones of these economists have actually spoken in the corridors of power, to very different extents of institutionalization, from being, you know, chief economist with the IMF, or being, you know, really critical policy actors in domestic central banks, and so on and so forth. I have not time to do that here, but just by eyeballing this, right? I mean, Jita Gopinath is a chief economist at the IMF. Now we know that, you know, the chief economist of the IMF is in the research division, which is a kind of think tank of the IMF. It's not a policy institution, right? They have Pisani Ferry, right? I mean, Pisani Ferry is a mandarin in around Macron. And certainly his ideas are reflected in Macron's positions. I have no time to demonstrate, however, a very direct causal link. You know, and there's a bunch of people like who are, have become mostly economic journalists, like Krugman, right? But there's, you know, I would say from eyeballing the numbers, about a third of them are frequently invited to Jackson Hole. And that is a, you know, that is a place of policy prestige, not just of intellectual one. So yeah, I mean, for now, they're talking mostly to themselves. We see Obama's former, Furman is here, right? Obama's former economic counsel. So we see some heavyweights from the corridors of power, but I think demonstrating their actual impact under these conditions requires a different project. And yeah, something to look into. Great question, thank you very much.
Another question comes from Julian, who says that maybe official economists have been told not to go public as not to subvert line the line of whatever their chiefs maybe yeah. care to plug.
Yes, that is generally the case. If you work for the state, I mean, of course, there's Peter Bofinger, for example, who's here, and he's known in you know to be very present in policy circles. So a couple of people that we coded are very very active there. This time around, Alessina Giovazzi are not in the inner circle of policy. I mean, they used to be influential in the European Council in 2008 when you know the expansionary austerity philosophy shaped the bailout programs. But yeah, I mean, we can think of some of the core. Interestingly, I don't know if I told you, when we look at the network, it's basically any Germans. I mean, the German government, there's like a German government economist, a bunch of universities, but they're all completely underrepresented. So central banks are not here. Germany is not here. If Germany is not here, I don't know how much power there is in these voices. Yeah, this is where I would leave it, I guess. It would be fantastic to have a network analysis being done on chief economic councils, heads of central banks, chief economists of central banks, and the chief economists of the most systemic, of course, of the C5, Perry, that you're writing on, but the chief economists of the largest institutional private institutions, let's say BlackRock, right, Deutsche Bank, right, and those people write as well. They could be also coded and have a private-public network here. That would be my next step.
Then we have a question from Roger Backhouse, who suggests that economists at the Fed and ECB could be quiet because they are too busy working out the details of policies their institutions are implementing. For example, once you have policy, there are a lot of details to be worked out. And to this one, Perry Merling again adds that a good source for this could be the BIS bulletin series. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, I mean, I'm very honored to get the question from Backhouse. I'm citing all the time, so I'm a bit coy about it. Okay, so absolutely. But here's the caveat, right? If you look at the sociology of the Fed, of the Fed as an organization, or of the ECB, you know, and Benjamin Brown has showed this, and Julia Johnson and other colleagues who work on this have showed that they always have people doing the communication bit, right? And they've been very cautious this time around. In the last crisis, you're getting a lot of economic discourse being generated by those people who are tasked to only do that. They're not research economists, they're not policy economists, they kind of are, you know, secondhand dealers in what are the ideas there, right? But I mean, the ECB ran out of bullets. I mean, essentially, they done PEP, and they don't have much left in the conversation, but they have a very impressive research department, which is less impressive than the Fed's in terms of where they publish and professional prestige, but it is quite impressive. And they have not been present in this particular network. I mean, again, you know, some of the economists I like the most in the world, Perry among them, are not invited so much to this place. You know, they have INET, they have other venues. This is a particular venue, and CPR, people in affiliated with CPR, they are on the Brussels Frankfurt trail. It's undeniable. They're also locked down at home. Let's keep that in mind. I don't know what they do on Zoom these days.
Then we have a question coming from a user on YouTube who says, it seems easy to think up of failures of economics to review itself. It is a very, very general question. What is the best example we have of economics becoming mindful of its shortcomings by way of world events?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean the world event, I mean, it's a macro world event that connects the Great Depression with World War II. I mean, that is the most systemic we've got. So, but let's keep in mind that paradigmatic transition took a very long time. It wasn't just that Keynes came around and 36 leads to a change in the next year. You know, it wasn't until the late 40s, early 50s that Keynesianism became locked into sort of the dominant paradigm. There was resistance there, right? I mean, you know, you had Lionel Robbins, you had, you know, Chicago was still around, right, in the trenches. And Queen Slobodian and others have showed that. So Backhouse as well. So, I mean, I'm saying, let's not hold our breath. The previous crisis, the drama with which many mainstream economists, especially inside the IMF, were writing about what could happen in the fall of 2008, reminds me a little bit of the tone being used here. But it didn't lead to you know, some kind of paradigmatic change. There's more pluralism in economics today. I think that political economists often exaggerate the homogeneous, seamless hegemony of neoliberalism. I think it is a much more variegated landscape than it used to be. And of course, the neoliberalism is kind of pathetic in many ways. I just try to hold it together with these assumptions that are common to the various new classical, new Keynesian spectra that we are dealing there. So I think to answer the question directly, that was the last time we saw that, right? We also saw it through violence. For example, in my book, I showed how, you know, Spain in for 100 years, essentially, was dominated by the German historical school, right? There were barely any neoclassical economists. They lived in the caves and cellars or something, right? But then the civil war came and they were all thrown out or, you know, fled or were killed. So you can have violent events, right? Hopefully that doesn't happen to Alberto Alesina, okay? So you could have war. You could have war. War has decredibilized, World War II has decredibilized the sort of sound finance implications that came from the neoclassical school of thought, right? And, you know, France, for example, used to be dominated by, you know, pretty neoclassical orientation, especially back among the France. World War II has completely obliterated that without France actually being very much into Keynes, as we know, right? I mean, these are my takes on it. Historically speaking, we have very few episodes that are similar in the level of economic violence in the developed countries with COVID, Spanish flu, World War II, World War I. And like I said, there's no clear pattern. World War I and Spanish flu did not lead to change. Great Depression, World War II did lead to change. 08 and COVID, 08 to a little bit of change, but not to paradigm flip.
Thank you. I would just like to add that the previous question was from Tiago Mata. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
If I didn't quote the name. Then we have a question from Mihai Sherej. Probably I'm pronouncing
wrong. Mihai Sherej, we're from the same town in Romania, yes. Okay.
Who asks, Keynes' general theory came out 7 years after the Great Depression started. Maybe it is just a bit too early to look at whether large shifts in economics are happening. And I will add also a second one from Lars Anland. What about the view of monetizing government debt?
Yeah.
Is there a changing view here?
Good question. So to Mihai's question, of course, yeah, I mean, it would be completely premature to expect that. I mean, a seriously rigorous research can only be done on awake, right? But we haven't had the kings, right, to come and disrupt the state of the art methodologically and intellectually. Now, however, when the Great Depression started in 1929, let's remember that there was under-consumptionism was a theory that was being used and deployed. The Stockholm School of Economics was an under-consumptionist school of thought. There were under-consumptionist ideas in so this idea of, you know, counter-cyclical spending because there isn't enough consumption is not, you know, Keynes basically did his own bricolage in many ways with things that were lying around for quite a while. So the Great Depression actually did usher in and gave a strong voice to the under-consumptionists, who then came to power, right, in Scandinavia. They ruled the social democratic governments of the Great Depression Scandinavia, introduced the welfare state, public works, and so on and so forth. So, of course, I'm not looking for a drastic change here, but I'm wondering to what extent some of the ideas that I saw in VoxEU, that whose implications cut beyond the end of the pandemic, I don't know how long that will be, but they see, you know, a permanent 2% stimulus financed in a very low interest environment into indefinitely, right? To address the climate crisis, to address inequality, to address, you know, the engines of the secular stagnation. So I wanted to what extent those particular ideas being present here on a very official stage, right, can be deployed by minds coming down the line in 7 years into something that could lead to change at the core of the profession, right? It's pure speculation, but we have to look for the seeds now, just like we looked for the seeds of Keynesian thinking into under-consumptionism in the 20s. Now, on the second question, monetizing government debt, right? No, that's not there. This Krugman comes close to it. There's no MMT, there's no... there's none. The answer is, here's the consensus, right? The consensus is, they even have, I forgot the exact, act fast and do whatever it takes. This is the slogan that Viplos agrees on in the introduction as summarizing what people agree with. But here's what happens. People say, okay, big bazooka a la Germany, right? Big stimulus. But if you can't afford it, if you're Italy, then there's only a European solution. ECB should not monetize this. They should support. So they are for Corona bonds. They are for ESM with no conditionality. They are for ECB emergency lending with no conditionality. This is the stand, including for the very radical people like Alessina. This is what they support, right? But they don't go as far as monetizing that. They would not, they don't say it explicitly. I mean, keep in mind, most of these macro debates started and kind of ended about 3 weeks ago. Maybe now they would be a little bit more valiant, but there is no support for it. There is some support for helicopter money, for propping up consumption, but there's nothing about refinancing the state in a direct way. It's pretty much defending, you know, what instruments we have in hand at this point. And most of the debate is before the collapse of the Corona bonds conversation.
Thank you. I'll take another two questions. The first is from Robin Latimer, who asks, is it possible that the sheer scale of spending and the prestige gained by public servants, such as doctors and nurses, will force a review of public policy? And the second question comes from Julian, who asks if there are any signs of policy-based evidence being produced.
Sorry, what was the second question? I didn't follow.
Julian asked if there are any signs of policy-based evidence being produced.
Okay, yeah, okay. So, No, these are editorial views. The only graph here is basically an intuitive hand-drawn graph by Pierre Gulinchas. But there is no, these are very short pieces for the most part. They were, Vox announced publicly they're going to do a peer review, a 48-hour peer review for short pieces. There is a lot, however, of evidence-based public policy analysis in microeconomics. So for example, there's a discussion if the Swedish model works better than others. If, you know, to what extent social distancing can lead to this and that kind of disruption in the supply chains, right? So there you have massive evidence, and the evidence is usually culled from the Chinese example. So, and that is basically part of the typical academic trail of having at least 3 months of research on pre-existing data from January from China and then apply to Europe later on in models. So yes, there is some of that, but not in macro. The macroeconomists have been either without data or lazy or they just went fast at this. And then the first question is, remind me?
The first question is, whether the scale of public spending,
yeah, okay,
and
remember,
the prestige,
yeah,
et cetera, et cetera.
Yes, absolutely. So there's a very explicit proposal by the biggest guns on the block here, right? Who support that wage increases for doctors and 5%, there should be a 5% of the European budget, right? European Commission's budget, just thrown at the medical sector, including wage increases, right? And bonuses and so on. So there is, I would say that a big part of the conversation is about how the costs of the medical emergency and the costs associated with rewarding the essential workers of the health sector should be kind of mutualized in Europe as a kind of like special item. And we know that has been done with some of the commission money went to the member states in the last 2 to 3 weeks. And in Romania, for example, they gave 500 euro bonuses to doctors in a country where, you know, the average minimum net wage is 300 euros. So it's quite a bit, right? So yeah, they do single out medical staff. They do single it out. They're not the Borg. I mean, they really get it, I think, at the human level.
Then we have a question from Maureen O'Dwyer. Who asks, it's a question related to gender.
Yeah.
So there is some evidence that female economists tend on average to be more Keynesian. And there is also evidence that female academics are publishing and writing less during the pandemic due to inequalities in childcare, etc. Mm. Could this end up skewing the debate?
I mean, as I said, the gender distribution is heavily, very heavily male. And there is, yes, there is literature with women more likely to be on the Keynesian end of the spectrum. It would be nice to, I mean, I don't know, it's so overwhelmingly clear that that this is, you know, a pretty clear strategy of suspending the state of the art for an exceptional Keynesianism. If they let in more women, if the literature is correct, and I think it is, probably Krugman and Pierre Gulinchas would not have been alone there. I mean, they're not alone. There's a bunch of people, but that crowd would have been more numerous, perhaps. So that said, okay, some of the, you know, I think it's pretty, I'm pretty confident to call Alessina a neoliberal, right? And I don't think he would be insulted by it. A lot of his work deals with gender inequality. He's actually pretty progressive on gender. We are looking at the larger structural, macro-structural aspects of it. But he does look at the kind of like micro-level gender inequalities in his research. They're not present in this book though, or this posts. There's a bunch of microeconomic analysis dealing with gender being published. I was actually surprised by the sheer amount of research papers on COVID published by behavioral economists and microeconomists and some finance economists that deal with gender inequality. So it is all there if you go on the website. I have not read it though.
Then finally, we have three questions from Cleo that are more that are relating more specifically to the research you have presented here, and they are questions on the network you showed. Yeah. She asks, what about the time lag in the production of research according to type of institution? Yeah. And what about the type of literature that is being produced there? So she asks if you had the chance to look at gray literature. And she also is curious to know a bit more about the use of the term COVID economics.
Yeah, it is COVID economics is a term that's being assumed by Vox. It's there. It's like it's one of the drop-down menus. It's called COVID economics, and it's being used around a lot. Right. I mean, it would be. Look, this is very limited. I was very interested in sort of transatlantic elite setting for policy relevant economics. But I think the next step is, I think about a year from now, we're going to get the peer reviewed stuff coming in. So we can do serious research on the effects on academic economics that in that regard. If I'm not mistaken, in the data set that I have used for looking at rational expectations and its disintegration or resilience, after the last crisis, the debate started about 7 months after Lehman with Taylor sparring with Woodford and others. So I guess the pandemic might last, so we don't have a very clear moment when we should start reading AER and Journal of Economic Literature to see what's happening there in the mainstream. And of course, heterodox thinking and so on is the stuff that fascinates me the most, but is not really invited at this table yet. And that might change. That might change because, as we know, if this thing lasts and we have violent second and third waves that are worse than this, then I think everything is up for grabs.
We have a new question that has just come in from Philippe van Bassuizen, who thanks you for the very interesting talk and says, there has been a lot of talk about the health economy dichotomies, for example, when defending or attacking lockdown policies.
Yeah.
And he asks, might the exception Keynesianism that many economists are favoring be influenced by these dichotomies?
Maybe. I mean, I can, it is completely above my pay grade and outside of my familiar territory. So I don't think I can give a precise answer, but I could, you know, I could speculate that, you know, health economics is going to become big. And I think their variables should be incorporated into macro modeling. I'm hoping that the macro modeling will junk rational expectations personally. You know, we'll go towards a much more pluralistic methodology that would incorporate those. But I mean, if you think of what the cutting edge health economists are doing these days, they do a lot of, rather than assume, just basically make heroic assumptions about what the micro foundations of the models are. They first do ethnographic work to establish what those foundations are. And then they go and do the quantitative work. This is a cutting edge. I think 2008 has generated the crisis of confidence in the more reflexive sides of the profession. When I was in Boston, colleagues, graduate students at the Harvard Econ Department were thinking in these terms. I mean, they were not, they had sold out on very orthodox ways of doing things. And those working on health, this is what they were doing. They were doing very pluralistic methodology, doing ethnographic field work in Colombia and India, and then based on that establish the assumptions and then scale them up into models, but with very cautious conclusions. Okay, if that can travel into macro, right? Whoever is doing that is going to be the next Keynes, probably, and then the field might change very dramatically because it will be very hard for people to say there's going to be no more pandemics with certainty, since global climate change might lead to waves of pandemics, in which case the health economists will be at the forefront, as well as climate, climonomics, right? I mean, that's another field that stands ready to, or should, right, penetrate mainstream macro. And we are seeing that. I mean, look, if you look at what the central banks are doing in the network for greening the financial sector, where they declare very openly, right, all the C5 central banks, right, all the systemic banks, and then a bunch of others, declare climate change to be the single most important source of financial instability, right? Now, in order to do to have some kind of rigorous thinking about that, you cannot ignore climatologists and you know, climate scientists and so on and so forth. So I think economics, the writing is on the wall for mainstream economics and its insulation from other fields of hard and social science. I think the next wave of scholarship will integrate those, or this thing will be, you know, if you read Schumpeter in the 30s, he was very critical of how neoclassical economics was coping with the Great Depression, right? So it didn't mean that he changed very much, but he did notice the intellectual crisis. And I think mainstream macro is bound to be an intellectual crisis because of climate change and the likelihood of other pandemics coming. They have to borrow from and enroll other scientists into the confines of the profession. Its walls will have to be softened.
Cornel, thank you so much. I just want to get in there just to get a bit of a time check, because we are just past 5 o'clock, a little bit past 5 o'clock. And I just want to invite people who may have any more questions to post them through the chat. And just want to say, I have a question I can pose, and maybe with that we can have some closing remarks from you. So yeah, thanks everybody for hanging around for a little bit over. So one other thing that was coming to mind while hearing you just now was your kind of lens on the different types of academic debates that different types of economists are having. And it sounded like you were saying, or possibly suggesting, that sort of micro economists or others are kind of sort of more out there in some way, whereas macroeconomists was somehow lagging in some sense, or I wasn't quite sure what it was that you were describing as compared to other sub-disciplines. But what I was wondering was if you have any thoughts on how one might want to look at the influence that those debates are having on policy. So it takes us a little bit back to that very first question of Perry Merling on, you know, what are these debates? Are they a sounding board? What is the role of that sounding board? And how does it affect, possibly affect, the policies that are being taken? Because one can, you know, imagine down the line, return to austerity or something. So, or change it, you know, change institutions will make policy changes as things go on. And it would be interesting to just hear a little bit more about your view on how the sort of where you're shining the light, which is what a macroeconomist talking about today, how is that in your mind, sort of where would we look to see how that's may or may not be linked to the policy changes that we're seeing or might see down sort of in the immediate future? And anyway, that was just a question that came to mind. Yeah. And any closing remarks, and we can leave it there for today.
Yeah, thank you, Christina. And you know, I'm very fortunate to be here at CBS. You know, basically there's a bunch of 7 or 8 political economists who study, you know, the sociology of various expert elites, Bannon Seabrook, Eleni Tsingou, O'Neill Gadotti, and others, Lasse Hendrickson. And, you know, we look at extremely different fields, right? I focus on macroeconomists, others focus on tax expertise, etc. And the variation is immense. You know, if you look at tax economics, right? Perry mentioned here, BIS, but I've mentioned OECD, right? I mean, OECD has borrowed ideas, radical ideas on taxation, right? From former accountants who are basically NGO activists, right? So interlopers, they would be considered in macroeconomics. So some fields of economics are actually pretty permeable to expertise, be it non-credentialed expertise, just from practitioners, right? And so when it comes to your question about microeconomics, to what extent these kind of transformations in micro are reaching the power desks of the policy elite, right? It also depends. It depends on the social field that you're working with. But if you look at the sort of hierarchy, look at who got the Nobel Prize last year. It wasn't it's not a Nobel Prize. It's the prize of the Stockholm, of the Swedish Central Bank. It was microeconomists, right? And so the prestige has moved there. We know that the experimental method that has been used by Duflo and Banerjee has been used by the World Bank, right? It definitely traveled in policy circles. It's used that by the Indian government, by the Brazilian government, by some of the health reforms in Europe have claimed it. So, but we cannot, I mean, we need empirical evidence to adjudicate, you know, if they matter a lot more than macroeconomists do. Moreover, today, you know, to what extent high prestige economists matter for the Trump administration? They don't, right? This, I mean, to Paris' point, do you think that the Trump administration is actually reading Vox? I don't think they do very much. I mean, it's just an assumption, but I'd be extremely surprised if they were to peruse over the latest paper in COVID economics. Maybe, you know, Fauci on looking at the COVID economics and health, but I mean, in the economic team, I don't think so. And Fuhrman actually said this somewhere in some newspaper. Some European governments, definitely Macron is listening to Pisani-Ferry, right? Then in Germany, the most influential people around Angela Merkel are not economists, they're lawyers by training, right? The German policy-making elite is predominantly ordo-liberal lawyers. They're not this kind of Anglo-American trained elite. They're trained in domestic universities. And I have a separate study on that, actually, that looks at French and German elites in the European financial institutions. They're very much, you know, trained locally. So they don't participate in this. You know, Italian economists, say Draghi and others, they come from a very strong transatlantic elite. They are overrepresented. They are the most educated technocrats. They read Vox, they publish in Vox. So Southern European, Greeks, Italians, in particular, Spanish to some extent, but Greeks and Italians are overrepresented in being US trained, Vox EU publishing. You know, some of the people that in the network here that you can see associated, for example, with the Danish institutions are Italians, right? So it's a very transnational Southern European elite that's very high prestige. Do they matter for the local governments? They mattered in one technocratic government, probably for this one a little bit. But that's a question, that's an immense research agenda for this kind of sociology of economics that's not done enough, I think. I mean, it's the Copenhagen School of doing this here. And we need more empirical analysis that compares and contrasts the weight of microeconomists of high prestige with that of macroeconomists of high prestige, depending on various levels of analysis, international institutions or domestic governments, central banks versus treasuries, right?
Absolutely. And for anyone, in case people haven't come across your work with Kevin Gallagher on recalibrating policy orthodoxy, the special issue is really a showcase of new methods and techniques at sort of investigating policy expertise in slightly more in innovative ways, in ways, more formal ways, and really come to some great conclusions. So I'd thoroughly recommend that as a sort of showcase of some of the great work that CEBS, Copenhagen Business
School. But Christina, if I may, very quickly, right? The level of innovation, of methodological innovation that has taken place in macro, which is real, right? As you know, Kevin shows in his book on capital controls, for instance, right? Pales next to what's happening in micro. I mean, micro is really out there, and they are not ashamed to go to anthropology and use their tools, right? Whereas there is a sense of being a little bit snobbish in macro, right? And not really venturing into other fields very much. Something that the Keynesians did, you know, when they were doing not just business surveys, they were doing almost sociological work in businesses and households in the 50s and 60s, right? The tradition has been forgotten, displaced, as we know, by the rational expectations evolution. And I think, you know, that's the hard nut to crack. It's rational expectations. Is that with that goes, then the whole scaffolding goes.
Well, yeah, maybe that's a good place to pause also, sort of think about in the future and hopefully, in person when the opportunity arises for the seminar. But I think we should draw the conversation to a close and just give you a very warm thanks for your time.
I'm very grateful. And thank you for the splendid questions, really, from the audience.